Hello and welcome to the fourth lecture series on Mohs circle, or the second lecture video on the stress tensor. So previously we had discussed about the usefulness of stress tensor, the eigenvalue and eigenvector. So in this video we'll discuss about the 3D stress tensor, and to illustrate this I'll use the program that I had already used during the first two videos of this lecture series. So without being late, we'll start the video. So as previously mentioned, a stress tensor is the representation of the normal and shear stresses in matrix form. So we'll start from an easy example. Let's consider that the shear stresses that are acting on a particular plane are zero, and only the normal stresses are there. So in this page, we'll enter as sigma xx as 20 and yy as 12 and zz, that is the normal 10, and rest of the thing we'll put as 0. First thing, this one is sigma xx and this is sigma xy and this is sigma xz. So while putting a value of 0 at sigma xy, the sigma yx is also actually adopting that value, because in the previous video we have already discussed that the magnitude of sigma xy and sigma yx is actually same, but they act opposite to each other. Okay, so similarly here we'll put 0, and you can see that as we are putting 0 in the sigma xz position, the sigma zx position is also entering the same value as the sigma xz. So here also we'll put 0. Okay, so when we'll click the calculate button. Okay, so now we have some values, or we have some numbers like eigenvalue 20, 12, 10, that means the input itself, and this cos alpha, cos beta, cos gamma is actually the eigen vector, and the trend and plunge is the what is the direction of x, y and z axis, and what is their plunge. So okay, so for this simple example, like when we are putting all the shear stresses as 0, the eigenvalue, that is the principal stress, is itself the normal stress, that is 20, 12 and 10, and there will be no change in the trend and plunge of the 3 axis. Now by changing the matrix, we'll also change the orientation of the 3 axis. So for a 3 into 3 non-zero stress condition, let's put, okay, the normal stress, actually I am keeping the normal stress as it is, that is 20, 12 and 10, and I am changing the shear stress value, and for this one we will take 2, okay, for this one we will take 3, and for this one we will take 4. Okay, so we have some eigenvalue of 21.832060, 13.399971 and 6.76822, and we have some eigenvector value and also trend and plunge. You can also see the orientation of the original axis has been changed relative to the previous one, that is sigma 1, that is there is some change in direction, also change in the plunge, that is what is the angle it is making with the horizontal surface. So these things are changed, but still you can see that the angle between all the three axes is actually same. That means the angle between sigma 3 and sigma 1 is 90 degree. You can see the angle also between sigma 3 and sigma 2. Yes, it is also 90 degree, and sigma 1 and sigma 2. Yes, it is also 90 degree. So the angle between sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3, these are all 90 degree, but the trend and the plunge of the 3 axis, that is changed. So okay, so as we have already discussed that this eigenvalue, which actually represents the principal stresses that is acting on the plane. So how to calculate the eigenvalue, we have already discussed in the previous video. So yes, actually the calculation of eigenvalue is similar to the previous one. So for a 3 into 3 matrix, that is we have 20, 2, 3, then 2, 12, and 4, and then 3, 4, and then 10. Okay, so for this one, the eigenvalue will be 20 minus lambda, and here we'll get 12 minus lambda and 10 minus lambda, and we'll keep all other values as it is. So 2, 3, 4, and the determinant of this one is equal to 0. So actually we need to solve the equation, and by equating it to 0, we can get three values of lambda. That means we can get three eigenvalues, and actually these eigenvalues are 21.83, 13.39, and 6.76, so which is actually given in the calculate segment of that program. So actually it is impossible or really time taking to calculate the eigenvalue, but I have provided the website from which you can read and can try it by yourself to calculate the eigenvalue. Okay, then similarly we can also calculate the eigenvector. We'll try to calculate the eigenvector for the three eigenvalues, then we can mark here, we can get for lambda is equal to 6.76, the eigenvector is minus 0.118, minus 0.719, and 1, and for lambda is equal to 13.4, we are getting the eigenvector of minus 0.921, 1.54, and 1, and for lambda is equal to 21.83, we are getting a eigenvector of 2.68, 0.951, and 1. But to our surprise, none of the eigenvectors, that is the this one, the cos alpha, cos beta, cos gamma, these values, actually eigenvalues are not matching actually to our output, because we are getting 0.118, 0.719 for 6.76, but there is no 0.118 or 0.719 or 1. So what could be the possible reason for this? So actually in this case, the vectors are being normalized, where the normalizing factor is the magnitude of the vector, and the magnitude of a particular vector is the square root of all the three vector values. That means, for example, for lambda is equal to 6.76, we are getting values of minus 0.118, which is minus 0.719, and 1. So the magnitude of this eigenvector is actually the square plus square of 719 plus square of 1, and its whole root, which is actually in this case is equal to I have already calculated 2372893760151664. Okay, that it. So by just dividing those vector values by the normalizing factor, we can easily get these values that this program is calculating. So by dividing the 0.118 divided by 1.24, then 0.719 by 1.24, again 1 divided by 1.24, we'll get as minus 0.0953, and 0.5811 and 0.808. Now you can see that the last row of the cos alpha, cos beta and cos gamma, you can see that these are the values that is being calculated by this program. That is -0.0953. Okay, good. Then -0.5814. Okay, ours is 5811. It's okay. And the third one is 0.808. So 0.808. So like this, we can calculate the eigen. That means the normalized eigenvector for lambda is equal to 13.39 and lambda is equal to 21.83. So the next step is actually to calculate the trend and plunge of the three axes. And actually we were calculating the eigenvectors in order to calculate the trend and plunge of the three principal axes. So I just note down. Okay, for lambda is equal to 6.76, we are getting values of -0.0953 and -0.5814 and 0.808. That is the last row, we are getting this value. So if we will consider these as L and this one as M and this one as N, then the trend is equal to tan inverse L by M. Now there are three conditions. So the condition number one is equal, so condition number one is if both L and M are positive, both L and M are positive, then the final result will be 90 minus the magnitude of the output, that is tan inverse L by L, this output. So this one will be your final result, like this. Okay, like this. Condition number two is if any one of L and M is negative, then final result will be 90 plus the magnitude. Okay, then condition number three is actually if both L and M are negative, then the final result R will be 270 minus magnitude of output. Okay, so these are the three conditions. Okay, we'll also calculate for the value of 6.76. Yeah, or else you can also try it, because actually I have already calculated these values myself. You can also try according to these rules, and you can let me know in the comment section. And the plunge is actually sine inverse n, that is the third digit. So this one is the value of plunge. So as we can see that the trend of the sigma 1 is actually coming 19.57 and plunge is 19.4. Sorry, this is trend. Trend is called 19.57. So for sigma 2, trend is 122.88 and plunge is 29.11. And for sigma 3, trend is 260.69 and plunge is equal to 53.91. So that means, so as you can see here in the diagram, that that sigma 1 is lying somewhere here and sigma 2 is lying somewhere here and sigma 3 is lying actually somewhere here. So the angle between sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma, that is the sigma dash, we can say it is sigma 1 dash, sigma 2 dash and sigma 3 dash, it's still 90 degree. But actually what happened is that let's say if the if previously this one was like this, but now this is like maybe somewhere like, I mean it could be some at some or directed to northeast or northwest direction with some plunge. That means previously it was actually making an angle of 90 degree or 0 degree, that is 90 degree or 0 degree with the ground surface, that is this one axis, this z axis or the sigma 3 axis is actually making an angle of 90 degree with the ground surface or ground, and this one, that is the x and y axis, these two were actually making 0 degree with the ground. But not in this case, actually in this case the trend is also changed and the plunge amount of plunge is also changed, that is all the three are non-zero. That means these three axes are actually making a particular angle with the ground surface. So actually this calculation is actually very much important to structural geologists and people who are dealing with plate tectonic and deformation. So if you really like these videos, you can let me know that you can let me know in the comment section, and I will try to bring some important or cool stuff to you regularly. So thank you for your time and thank you for listening to me.